But that first question I always ask is, why are you playing? Mm-hmm. What's your reason for playing? Mm-hmm. Right. And a lot of times the answer I'll get is, well, I want to provide for me and my family, or I want to, you know, be the best I can be. And some of the answers I always ask is, okay, if you could provide for you and your family the way that you see this game can through a different way, mm-hmm. would you still play the game? You know what I mean? And they always, you know, they have a moment of pause. And another instance of, I just want to be the best I can be, say, well, what does that look like? That's a cliche answer. What does the best you can be actually look like? So the word of encouragement I always give is, find who you are. Mm-hmm. Who are you within God's image? Everybody was made within God's image, but like, who are you within God's image? Like, you are uniquely you.
Hello, everyone. This is author Tim Brown, the book, Uncommon Athletes Filled with Passion, Fueled by Purpose. And today I'm blessed to have a purposeful young man on the show who's found his purpose and who's living his life, just impacting others. And so today we'll be talking with Traevon Jackson, a Columbus, Ohio, Westerville native who's now living in sunny L.A. up there in all that sunshine, left us here with the snow and all that. But I want to remind those who haven't subscribed to the channel, please hit that subscribe button and like, so we continue to broadcast these episodes. So Traevon, welcome to the show.
Man, thanks for having me, Coach Brown. It's good to see you, man.
Great to see you. Yeah, we go way back to the NCAA first team basketball days. You know, we used to hang out every summer at the conference, and then living here in Columbus, had the opportunity to follow your career, just excited for all those great things that you've done. Both of us being men of faith, you know, I work for the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. I always ask young men of faith, when did God become real in your life?
Man, that's a great question. You know, I always believed in God, always. I grew up, my mom instilled that into me heavy. You know, knowing that God was real. I never not had an opportunity, you know, where God wasn't real in my life. I remember being younger and playing video games, getting upset, throwing the controller at the screen. God, why you let me lose? You know, stuff like that. But I know it took a turn to me. When I was in college, for me, it was my sophomore year. Going into my freshman year, and I got a chance to meet someone who changed my life, who helped introduce me to what I was always looking for. Mm-hmm. And a lot of this stemmed, but a lot of the seeds were planted from people, you know, like my mom or Coach Kalo planted some major seeds in my life. And then, you know, Dr. Roman, who was the starter of our agency, he took it to another level, because it was a time period in my life where I had to make a choice as a man. Mm-hmm. I was beginning coming into manhood. You know, you're still a young kind of kid,
right?
And going into college. But at that time, the decisions that I started to make then really started to have an effect on my future. And that's when I needed to get some purpose and envision as far as understanding what's going on here in life. And that's when I dove all in.
Amen. Yeah, you said a great thing there. The Bible says one man plants, another one waters, but God gets the increase. So you had to planting those seeds, and then Anthony came along and Caleb threw some water on it.
Yep.
And God gets the increase. That's how it works. That's a great testimony. It's a great testimony for young people as well. You know, it's transition, mm-hmm. going life. At some point, you got to make a decision at some point.
You know, got to.
Which way you want your life to go. You come to that crossroad. You were blessed to have a great high school, college career. You guys won the Big Ten Championship, regular season champs. You went to the two Final Fours, back-to-back Final
Fours,
as a matter of fact. And then even in high school, you had the longest winning streak there at Westerville South. Can you talk about the life lessons that you learned from those experiences?
Oof, that's a lot. A lot of life lessons. I started high school. I mean, one life lesson I learned in high school from Coach Kalo that always stood out to me, so many things that he said that stood out to me, but the main thing that he stood out to me was, like, take advantage of your time while you're in school, like, while you're here. Because he would always say, like, I'm going to be here once you guys leave. You guys only get 4 years.
That's good.
So I had a great high school experience because I really believed and bought into the philosophy of, like, one day at a time. Like, mm-hmm. I really did. I remember I got to a point where I just didn't know how to get better because I was so focused on just how can I get better this year, but I didn't know how to get better for like my future because I was so bought in to like the now. And he really helped us be present in that. And then moving in college, the lesson I learned was because I was so present in now, then everything flipped. I went like, you know, they say too far left, too far right. Like I went all the way, you know, right or whatever. And I was just thinking just about the future. And so a lot of my experiences in college, I don't really necessarily remember fully. I remember bits and pieces, but I don't really remember because I wasn't present there all the time. And the thing that I learned from that experience is to have a balance of both. All those things that I just talked about as far as present and future will determine how you deal with relationships, how you deal with success, how you deal with finances, how you deal with everything that affects your life. So those are that's the main lesson I say I learned.
Yeah, it's amazing how God prepares us for what he has to do in the future. You know, he takes us through some things. Even that heartache in the Final Four, you know, and you've been injured and have, you know, missing that and being able to come back, all those experiences, you know, and they're not really for us, to be honest. They're for someone else, you know.
Exactly.
He takes us through so we can comfort others, you know, because you can really say, hey, I've been there, you know. You know, I know what you're dealing with. You know, I've been there, and I can help you through. Let me share my experience with you, you know, on how I got through it, how I got I got through it with a smile on my face. Just look back at it.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't pretty then, trust me, but.
Man, it was not.
Now, as you look back, it's part of the journey. Let's talk about your recruiting process and how did we let you get away? You know, we know that your dad was a player at Ohio State and all that. And then you go to Wisconsin in the Big Ten. Almost like rubbing it in our face. You know, you could have went outside the Big Ten.
It's funny we're talking about this because we were just talking about this not too long ago earlier in the summer. You know, Mata got a lot of slack for not recruiting us guys out of the Ohio area. And it's not really his fault, but like we were good young, but we weren't like the top prospects young. So the program like him, they would recruit guys that were freshmen, sophomores, and get them off the board early. And, you know, he would go to the top 100. We weren't top 100, you know, high school players at the time. So what ended up happening was Mata recruited me. I remember them being at they had an assistant coach, and he came to my game against Reynoldsburg. Stunk it up. Stunk the game up, didn't play well. But I had been playing well all the other times they seen me play. I went to Ohio State camp. Mm-hmm. They came to some scrimmages, went to a couple games. But I think that game for them kind of solidified, all right, they're going to kind of go in a different direction. Mm-hmm. I remember going on a visit to a football game, and they were like, yeah, you know, anytime you want to come back, let us know. Right. So they played Penn State next. Right. And Penn State was like a big game, and I was like, I want to go to the game.
Right.
So I remember Anthony Kalo, who was my, you know, Coach Kalo's son, assistant coach at the time, he was kind of helping me through the process. I was like, man, let's see if we can go to the game. He was like, all right, so we'll try. No response. And then I kind of knew at that point, Ohio State might not be it. So it's not really that they didn't recruit me. They didn't at a certain time. They did at the beginning, but it wasn't necessarily an option because what ended up happening is they got Shannon Scott early, and they already had Aaron Kraft. Right. So by the time guys like myself, Travis Trice, Trey Burke, Trey Lewis even, guys in Ohio that really came up and really had great careers, he had already made his decision as far as who he wanted to have on his team, and we kind of blossomed later.
Right. So when did Wisconsin come into the picture?
So I was going to go to Arizona State. Mm. A lot of people don't know this, but – so Coach Kalo had a great relationship with Herb Sendek, who was the head coach. Mm. And Coach Kalo pulls me to the office one day, my junior year, because I really took some major leaps. And he said, I haven't done this for anybody since Adam Wolf, since 1998 or something. And I was 2010 when he did this. So, you know, it was over 10 years. He said, I'm going to call Herb Sendek for you and get him to come here. You know, Coach Kalo's big on his word, so that when he says it, they can come. So right away, the assistant coach flew out.
Wow.
I had some of the most unbelievable open gyms in my life. Like he was trying to offer me on a spice that we can't do it because coach is right. But I'm going to come back. And he came back, and Coach Sendek was like, we're going to offer you. So that was my first big offer. I had Akron, I had Ohio, I had a lot of the mid-majors, which was great. Mm-hmm. But, like, my first big offer was Arizona State. And I was going to go. Like, I was set on going. I loved the West Coast. My uncle lived right there in Tempe. So mm-hmm. I would have had family that was, like, right there. So what ended up happening was, I remember talking to Coach Ryan. I always tell this story. And he calls me, and he's just, Coach Ryan for Wisconsin, because they hadn't offered yet. They had been recruiting, but they still didn't offer. Once Arizona State offered, then, you know, all these star schools right. starting to start getting interest right. and offer. So he calls me, and he says, yeah, so I heard you're thinking about going to Arizona State. I said, how'd you hear that? Like, I didn't tell nobody. Like, how'd you hear that? Right. And he was like, well, look, man, they got a lot of guards. They got a lot of guards on their team. And, you know, think about it. Do you want to really go play there for your career with all those guards? And lo and behold, we had Jordan Taylor, who was the number one point guard in the nation. We had Josh Gosher, George Marshall, all these guys going to Wisconsin. But I listened to what he said. Mm-hmm. So he did a wonderful job of just telling me what I wanted to hear, playing the, you know, as close to home card. And, right. you know, they kind of got me with that. And at first it was tough going there because I felt like the truth wasn't portrayed correctly, mm-hmm. but it ended up being a great journey that I did experience at Wisconsin.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. So he played that close to home card. Huh?
Oh man, he played all the cards.
Can't get out to Arizona.
We want you to be the next Jordan Taylor. We want you to be this, like all that. I was like, oh, let's get it. Like,
right. So it sounded like it worked out pretty good for you.
Yeah, no, it did. It did.
Yeah, it was a good choice. You know, when you began playing basketball, and everybody know that you're the son of Jimmy Jackson, the great Ohio State legend and NBA player. How did that impact you?
It was great. But I didn't really accept it, honestly, until I got into adulthood. I fought it a lot because a lot of people don't understand, but like I met my dad later in life. So a lot of the things that happened from a foundational childhood stance, I didn't accept being a son. Like I didn't know what that was like to be a son. Mm-hmm. So my whole thing was, I'm going to be better. I want to be my own person. You know, I want to leave the house, take all the riches with me. And that made it harder. So I didn't really get over it until I was about seventh, eighth grade. And that's when I finally started to come into my own. Mm-hmm. Like, all right, people started to not call me Jimmy's son, but Trevon. Mm-hmm. Like, I remember that was a big thing me and my dad would always talk about. Like they called it, you're Trevon's dad, not Jimmy Jackson. No, you're Trevon's dad. That was a big shift.
Right.
So it at times it was a hindrance for me. You know, I look back, we were just talking about this the other day with my dad. I was like, man, I wish I'd have listened to you more to be able to accept what it is you have for me instead of fighting. Mm-hmm. My dad was great. My dad was wonderful for me. Not just on the court, but I'm talking about just as a dad. Like he just wanted to see the best for me, but he did such a wonderful job because he allowed me to go through my process and my journey without trying to force anything on me. Mm-hmm. And when it was time for me to, you know, change my mindset and get everything together, that's when he came to me with open arms and was like, I'm here. So that was kind of how I dealt with that whole situation with my dad growing up.
Yeah, it's kind of an African proverb says this, when the student is ready, the teacher will appear.
Yeah.
Yep. Student's ready, the teacher will appear. When you were ready, dad was just waiting, you know.
He was just sitting there waiting.
He was sitting there waiting when you were ready, you know. And after, you know, after your great college career, you played overseas, you had played some summer league and trying to work your way into the NBA. When did you finally realize it was time to move on to the next chapter in your life?
Well, I realized that for me, COVID was a microcosm of what happened the year before. So it's like, I always tell people, like, I experienced the COVID year before because the decisions that I made in my pro career, I could have played a lot longer, but the decisions that I made made my pro career come to a halt sooner than most. And what I mean by that is because of that pride that I had, because of that prove it mentality, I made some decisions that set me back rather than going forward. So like, I remember coming out of school, I had opportunities to go to G League right away. You know, opportunities to even go to overseas. My whole thing was league. If you don't make it to the league, you're not it. And that's not the case at all. It was, everything's a stepping stone. So my last couple years were some of my best years playing, because I ended up going to Slovakia after I played in the minor league just to get some film. Ended up going to Slovakia. And then my last year ended up playing in Sweden. But in between that Slovakia and Sweden time, I tried to get back to the G League. And I got invited to the Bucks camp, played some preseason with them. That's not preseason, but like before preseason with like their mini camp. I was playing with the Bucks players, and they invited me to their G League camp. And then end up not making the team. You know, I had a meeting with the GM and everything, say, hey, we're going to go a different direction. I said, cool. That really was tough for me at the time. But I still had Sweden overseas waiting for me. So I went to Sweden. But throughout that time, I really had to start thinking about life outside of basketball. That was my first time I really sat down and said, all right, I got to start figuring out what I'm going to do outside of the court, because I can't deal with this up and down all the time. Yeah. And so I had already decided I wanted to get into media. I wanted to get in, but I didn't know how. I wanted to get into, you know, the mentorship program, the things that I'm doing now, but I didn't know how. And I wanted to do that while I was playing. So I started setting that up while I was playing. Then all of a sudden, you know, all the events happened in 2020, Kobe, COVID, all these major events. And that's when I was like, whoa, I'm glad that I set this stuff up, because now I at least have something to do. I didn't have it all the way set up, but I at least have something to do. And I had some help that really helped me along the way with that as well. Dr. Roman really helped me a lot with that as well, and other people as well. So that's when I knew, going through that year, I was preparing for the next year after COVID. And slowly but surely, my passion for working out and for the game wasn't there. So I was a workout, you know, like they say, workout warrior. I could wake up and, you know, work out till I was blue in the face, because I just loved the game, but I didn't want to do that anymore. And that's what I remember. I had a lot of instances or a lot of things that happened in my life, but then I had a real, super real experience where pretty much God was revealing to me the reason why my passion was being removed from basketball, was because I played basketball for love, for the love that you get from people, for the relationships, all that. That love was filled. The love that I was looking for was, I had found it at a higher level. So I no longer needed the basketball for that. Because I truly never really loved basketball when I look back at it. Like, I loved it for what it could bring, but I didn't necessarily just love the game. I love working out. I love the process. But I used to get nervous in games. Like, I used to get nervous before those things. So it hit me, like, that's why I'm not feeling passionate. And, you know, once you don't feel passionate about getting better, it's time for you to, hey, you better. And I always told myself that I'm never going to play this game half-heartedly. Like, I'm going to give everything I have. And once it's time to walk away, it's time to walk away. And I was content.
Let's talk about how you got involved in God's Image. So your podcast and some of those things that you're doing in that space, kind of in that media space. Can you kind of talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, well, it started my freshman year going into college. My freshman year going to college, I met Dr. Roman, and he had a mentorship program where he trained guys, and he trained guys basketball. And this whole thing was bringing God into basketball. Now, at the time when I heard him, I wasn't trying to hear that. I'm trying to get to the league. You helping guys get there, I'm going to listen to you because of that. But then it really started to change my life. Going into my sophomore year, I dealt with some things myself. And all the seeds he had been planting and the things that he had been telling me, it finally made sense. So I got all in. Man, this stuff works. The stuff he's saying actually works. And I seen the impact that it had as far as people's lives in my own life. I was like, there's got to be this. So I wanted to be able to give to others what I experienced. And that's how to be a pro started. How to be a pro started, which is a branch of In God's Image, our mentorship program now. It is teaching guys how to be a professional in all aspects of the game, you know, physically, emotionally, mentally, soulfully, spiritually, the whole part of things. So now you're not just out here just playing, just being a product, but you can actually decide where you want to go. You can create your reality as a pro. You can do all the things that you want to do while actually fulfilling God's will and God's purpose. So that's kind of how I bought all into it. It took a while. took some years, but I'm definitely where I need to be today.
Yeah, I think God has a way of getting our attention. You know, he definitely, definitely has that. Yeah, he can get our attention. He say, hey, something better I have for you, you know.
Yep.
This is good, but there's something better I have for you. And we talk about that fulfillment, you know, being fulfilled, you know. And we try so many different ways to be fulfilled. And only fulfillment is in that relationship with Jesus, you know, knowing that.
Yeah, I took a lot of things to try to be fulfilled. Ain't nothing work.
Can you talk about the importance of, you hit on a little bit, the importance of players taking care of their mental health? You know,
Well, it's so important because mentally, that's our bridge, right? Our decision for what we decide to do, like which side of the spectrum of life we're going to live on. That spectrum meaning like, whether that spectrum be the side of life, the side of death, the side of blessings, the side of curses, like which path are we going to choose? And a lot of the times what happens is we go throughout our journey, guys will see success from guys going down a path I call the negative side of the spectrum, where they see themselves, well, I can do that and I can be successful, but they don't understand the things that come on the back end. Mm-hmm. So like we always hear the mantra, like more money, more problems, more, you know, success, more haters, stuff like that. Right. And people don't understand why that actually comes. Well, it comes because you can get it by your birthright, by God's birthrights that you've been given. You can go out and do what you want to do, but it's still a cost. Everything's got a cost to it. And so a lot of times people are getting this quick hit success and this initial success, but not understanding what's going on in the unseen of things. And your mind, the mental health part of things, is fighting like, well, I want to keep going, but your real part of yourself is saying, but hey, this is what you're going to deal with, but you just keep dismissing it. So the mental health comes in because our true selves know, okay, we can get the fullness of this success, but why does it got to come with all this turmoil and all this hate? Why does it got to come with all this hurt, right? And a lot of the times is because we don't take the time to first and foremost know who we are, to understand what's the purpose of things. What's the whole reason of actually getting to these platforms anyways? What's the whole reason of becoming the best anyways? I always ask guys, why do you want to play? Like, what's your reason for playing? Once you deal with those things, your mind can actually be at ease. You won't have to try to always fight. You won't have to always try to, you know, take and claw your way through. So the mental health comes into that because now I can set up my team around me correctly. Now I can know how to use my finances correctly. Now I can know how to use my relationships and my career correctly, because those are all the things that affect the mental health as a player, not the game. We all know how to shoot. We all know how to pass. We all know how to dribble. It's the how to deal with the coach, how to deal with the girl over here, how to deal with your money situation over here. It's those things. And all that stem from that initial decision of, well, I'm going to go forward this way. And even, well, and I don't know what that means. That this way is what I mean. It's like, I don't know the consequences of this way and what that means. Once you know it, oh, I can sit down and say, okay, do I want to do that or not? And that's kind of what is so important for mental health in the game of all athletes.
That's good stuff there. That's good stuff. You kind of broke that down, you know, putting in all those different compartments, you know. I think athletes have to deal with so many different compartments. You know, it's not just playing the game, because they got that figured out. Obviously, you know, we've been given that talent, but it's the other side. And sometimes they need help in that area. You know, that's something they may not be good at. You know, and it's okay to get. I think we're realizing the world now, it's okay to seek out help.
You know, it's very okay.
That it's okay to seek out that help. So as you and your team interact with players, what word of encouragement would you give to guys on how to navigate that college and pro side of basketball?
Well, that first question I always ask is, why are you playing? Mm-hmm. What's your reason for playing, right? And a lot of times the answer I'll get is, well, I want to provide for me and my family, or I want to, you know, be the best I can be. And some of the answers I always ask is, okay, if you could provide for you and your family the way that you see this game can through a different way, mm-hmm. would you still play the game? You know what I mean? And they always, you know, they have a moment of pause. And another instance of, I just want to be the best I can be, say, well, what does that look like? That's a cliche answer. What does the best you can be actually look like? So the word of encouragement I always give is find who you are. Mm-hmm. Who are you within God's image? Everybody was made within God's image, but like, who are you within God's image? Like, you are uniquely you. So what does that look like? And depending on how they receive it, if I can talk to them that way, I can talk to them that way. If I need to talk to them a different way, I'll say, who are you, right, directly. And the thing with what that is I always say is, once you find out who you are, now you can focus on your true desires, the true things that were placed within you, you know what I mean, from God. Now everything else is external. You can just move forward and focus on that. Life is easy. Yeah. Life really doesn't have to be. Like, that's one thing that bothers me is people always be like, life is hard. Life is hard. Like, no, death is hard. Life is actually not hard. Life is actually easy if you just follow it the right way. Because life is God, and God is not a hard God. So that's the main word of advice I would give the guys is find out who you are. And in order to find out who you are, you need to go out. You need to go to who you came from. Mm-hmm. You need to actually go there. And once you start trying to figure that out, your guy going to be sitting there waiting like, come on. Like, come on, big fella. I've been sitting here. Come on through. Like how you said my dad was earlier, the teacher appears. Right? When you're ready.
Ready. So, whenever you're ready. God says, this Bible says, he stands at the door and knock, you know.
He's sitting there.
He's not going to kick in the door on you now.
He's a gentleman. I ain't about to do that.
Waiting there. There are choices. There are choices. While we on this good, while we on these good life lessons, you know. I tell you, one of my challenges, can you speak to these guys about, you know, once you do make that change, you know, and how can you handle the reaction of certain people? You know, because certain people, they don't want to hear that part, man.
They ain't trying to hear it.
I want the old part, man. What you talking about?
Oh,
You don't do this no more. What's going on here, man? Let's go. No, I'm a changed man now.
I literally had that, bro. I had a dude tell me, we went to old Trevon back. Old Trevon is in the grave. He is dead, bro. Like, you're not getting him. Yeah. I mean, it comes a part of the territory. It's like, he specifically told us, like, take heart. The world hated me. Yeah. They're going to hate you, too. Like, you're fine. And I think the knowledge of it is key, though. Mm-hmm. And I think the hardest part is family, though. I know. The hardest part is family because we're literally changing lineages and families from our earthly family to God's family. And it causes a friction. That's why he said, I didn't come to bring peace. I came to bring a sword to separate mother-in-law from daughter-in-law. Mm-hmm. You know, all these different relationships and he specifically said law. And he specifically said law because you guys were married in law. You guys made a family in law where y'all can decide that, but that wasn't my will. I'm getting you back to being in family with me and my will. That's going to cause a division. So we feel that inward division when we make this decision to give up our life. And it comes into, what does it say in the beginning? Like enmity or enmity, whatever the word means, with the rest of our other families and other relationships. And we got to make a choice. Right. You either for me or get. And a lot of times, if you don't understand the process, it feels like you're alone. Feels like there's nobody else around. It feels like there's nobody here. And it seemed like I'm crazy. You know what I mean? People try to start saying you in a cult and all type of stuff. Right. What's going on? And don't have a personal relationship with God and you know everybody else because that doesn't work that way. It doesn't work. So the thing that I always try to help guys get is like understand the process of why things work the way they work. Mm-hmm. How do you understand? You got to seek after God. Ask. It's your birthright. He said, if you ask for wisdom, I'll give it to you. Just don't doubt. Don't be like a man waving to and from the sea. I'm going to give you what you ask for. Just don't doubt. Mm-hmm. And when you stand and hold on to that, you'll continually keep going. You'll get a community around you. You'll get the family and things that you need. God will never take stuff away without replacing it. Mm-hmm. That's not how God works. Like, he always gives stuff back that was taken away. So if you lost the best friend, you'll have another best friend come. It might be in the unseen first, but it's going to come through somebody eventually in the scene. Stick with the process and just don't grow weary in doing good. In due time, you'll get there. You'll reap the harvest that you're asking for. Just move forward. Don't quit. Don't go back. Because if you go back, I've seen that so many times. Mm. Or if you just make this decision, then all of a sudden you decide to go back to how you lived in the world.
Right.
It get harder. Now it's hard to get back to that initial childlike faith that you had. Like, you know. So
that's good. There's a couple of scriptures came to mind when you were sharing that. One is, greater is he that's in you that's in the world.
Yep.
Greater is he that's in you that's in the world. When you have God inside of you, that's greater than the world. And then,
absolutely.
And the other one is, once you get on that journey, you begin to realize that there actually is more for you than there are against you.
There really is.
There's more for you than there are against you, man. And God will send, all of a sudden God will see you. He'll start sending those people to you. And then it'll click. Oh, man, I'm not out here by myself.
I'm not out here by myself.
I thought I was the only one. You know that?
Yeah.
But yeah, there's more for you than there against you. As we wrap this up, it's been a great conversation. Can you tell our audience how to get in touch with you? How can they get in touch with you to maybe be part of the in God's image?
Yeah, definitely. So we have our mentorship program that people can be a part of, whether it be on Instagram, Facebook, things like that. But the website you can go to is wearegodsimage.com.
Okay.
/IGI, how to be a pro. So it's wearegodsimage.com/IGI, how to be a pro. And then from there, you'll see all the information, how to get contact with us. We have an actual tutorial of, you know, drills and skills and things. And we also have a talking tutorial as well, like the journey of, we call it our give and go section, mm-hmm. where we give you the information so you can take and go with it, of just what it's like to be a pro.
Right.
And we got contact information to me, Scott Boogie, my partner in it. And then we got our podcast link on there as well. And then all that links to our agency, because this is all a division of our agency, IGI Sports. All that is on that link. It connects to that link on wearegodsimage.com/IGI, how to be a pro.
Great, great. We'll make sure we put that on the screen there so everybody will get that. All right. Well, it's been a pleasure talking to you, and I'm looking forward to following, continue to follow you and all the great things that you're doing. So just
Definitely. I'm excited to see you, Coach. It's been a while, man. I'm glad I got a chance to run into you, but I'm excited to see you again. So it's going to be good to see you here soon.
All right. Be blessed.
All right. You too, Coach.